Sorry, so today we're going to talk about Microsoft and Linux. There's been a lot happening over the course of the last year about kind of the Microsoft engagement with open source, the Microsoft engagement with Linux, you know, Docker, GitHub, just, you know, Jenkins, Red Hat, everybody. So we're going to talk a little about what that means, why Microsoft is getting so knee-deep into Linux. And I think I'll start it this way. You know, Microsoft won a lot of the battles against Linux, but Linux won the war, right? When it's all coming down to the end, you know, Microsoft is fully embracing Linux. You know, Linux is 65-70% of the workloads in Azure today. They recognize that there's some real advantages to the Linux operating system. And in fact, they've gone so far as to kind of start emulating some of the stuff that Linux is doing. And, you know, there is no greater compliment than to emulate, you know, your competition. So, and that's what NanoServer is all about. It's kind of a really small footprint and very robust operating system. So we'll talk a little bit about that as well. And feel free to ask questions throughout. I'm really good at kind of changing gears if need be. But I do have a lot of content to get through. I tend to talk fast. I will try to slow down. If I do go too fast, just, you know, let me know. Slow down. Do that. I'll get the picture. A big slide here. Lots of stuff. And really what I want to talk about on this is all the investments Microsoft has made in open source and how they're really fueling the open source message, not only within Microsoft, but within the broader community. You look at some of the partnerships we've made, like with Eclipse, with Red Hat, Jenkins, you know, some of our products that we've open sourced. You've got some of the ones we've got on here, like SQL Server runs Linux. Who knows SQL Server now runs in Linux or is being developed for Linux? What about PowerShell? Who knew that PowerShell is now open sourced, right? Who knew that there's a PowerShell for Linux, right? All stuff that Microsoft is doing to really embrace the Linux ecosystem and the open source ecosystem. And you know, within Azure is a huge play for Microsoft in the Linux story. Now I'll go deeper into some of that as we go along. Microsoft has over 600 million lines of code that are written in by our employees in open source today. .NET, in fact, the Visual Studio code is all open source, right? You know, Microsoft released it for free, and then just made it open source. And that was really our beginning of actually taking our products and just, you know, letting it go. So, you know, I really like how this came about, and we'll talk a little bit later about really what drove this transformation within Microsoft. This is a keynote that was delivered last month, I think it was about a month ago, at the 2016 Microsoft Connect event. This was during the keynote. The president, the CEO of GitHub, Chris Weinstrath, and you know, he announced who the top contributors on GitHub were. Microsoft took the top spot with 16,419 contributors to the open source community. You know, Facebook, Docker, not sure who the fourth one is, and then Google wrapped up the top five. So Microsoft is really serious about open source. It's not just Linux. It's not just our products that we're releasing to the open source. It's giving back to the community all up within open source. And I also want to talk a little bit about containers. And I'm going to go through this really, really quickly. This is just an introduction to containers. I'm just going to show a hands. Who's worked with containers or Docker before? Who's never? Have you guys ever seen containers? Seen containers?
Yeah.
Okay. So I'm going to go through this really quickly just because I want to level set you on what containers are. Because part of the DevOps story is all about containers. And really that's kind of where Microsoft is going, which leads us right into the Linux story. So I'm going to tie it all together in a little bit. So what is a container? A container is application, OS, and hardware, very much like a VM where it's stacked on top of each other. But it's different in the fact that in traditional hardware virtualization, the hardware is virtualized and you have your OS and your application sitting on top of that same hardware. So in virtualization, you're virtualizing the hardware layer. When you move into a container environment, you still have the hardware, you still have the OS, but instead of virtualizing at the hardware layer, you're virtualizing at the operating system layer. Okay? So then you have your kernel and your applications running inside the operating system, and the containers run the applications on inside of that same operating system. And I'll go a little bit deeper in this in a couple of slides. By the way, I don't have a zillion slides. I'm going to go through a few that, because the visuals kind of help me stay on course and also helps me deliver the image. I really can't get to in a demo. So Microsoft, we have two different kinds of containers. By the way, all of our containers are completely 100% Docker compatible. We basically use the same Docker API, so the same exact calls will work exactly the same on Windows as they do on Linux. And we just added a few things that give you extra capabilities whenever you're managing Docker inside of Windows. But we have Windows Server containers. In a Windows Server container environment, just like in Linux, you have a shared kernel. Your container set on top of that shared kernel, and that's where your applications run. You do have isolation at the application layer. You don't necessarily have isolation at the kernel layer. So for high-level security environments, for certain regulations, you can't use a shared kernel. So you wouldn't be able to use a Docker solution in that case. So we also develop Hyper-V containers, and that gives you isolation at the kernel layer. Now the thing that's different about Hyper-V containers is they still give you all the advantages of Docker and containers. The same codes, the same commands, the same APIs, the same everything. The difference is the kernel is separated. It's still portable too, because you know the container. One of the great things about the containers is the portability. But what you have is the kernel is embedded inside the container as well, so it gives you a lot more security with Hyper-V containers.
As far as I know, though, containers really can't be moved between various versions of Linux. Sometimes they can. And for instance, you couldn't take container built, let's say for Ubuntu, and move it over to a Red Hat kernel.
Correct. Yeah. So, and the reason for that is because you do have a shared kernel. Right?
Yes.
It is literally running on the same code. I'm going to show you in a couple more slides how that's good and how that's bad. Right.
That's actually one of the cases on the binary level.
Yep.
If you pull it down from like GitHub or something. Basically building it from the Docker bio, it's not really an issue.
Correct, because it depends on what the base is, because it's going to lay down a base image and you're going to install on top of that base. Correct. Okay, so the Docker integration. There's a lot of stuff on this slide. I'm not really going to talk too much to it. I just want to give you kind of a clue that this was not an easy job for Microsoft to do. And it was not just a Microsoft job. Docker really dove in with us in a joint strategic partnership to drive containers forward. And what our partnership goes way beyond what we're doing in the operating system and with containers on Windows. Really, it's allowing the floodgates to be open because now Microsoft's marketing muscle is applied to containers because you know we've got 50,000 people out talking about containers and how they improve your ability to deploy applications and have isolation and you know integrate DevOps solutions and all that stuff. So literally, Docker is working with us and speaking with us and working you know one-on-one with us in some cases with our customers to help drive containers and. So it wasn't a one-time investment with Docker. This is an ongoing joint partnership that really benefits both sides. It benefits Microsoft in the fact that they have resources at Docker. They have this partnership to put that code, to put those APIs right into the operating system. and that ongoing support as they continue to evolve the product. And not only that, they're contributing back directly to Docker to improve the Docker product as well. So it's a two-way street. Some things that Microsoft has added recently, Bash on Windows, I've got a link here. These slides I'll make available on my blog, itproguru.com/resources. They'll be right on the top of that page. But here's a link to the how to enable that. Who's running Windows 10 today? Okay, that's about what I figured, about half. Actually, in most groups, it's more like 90%, but this is a Linux user group, so that's okay. And you'll see what it looks like right here on the right hand side on the image. It's, you know, I typed in Bash on my start button, and there it is on the next one down. I have Git installed on my machine, but next down is Bash on Ubuntu on Windows. So what it's actually doing is it's downloading a conical image, dropping that on the machine, and it's launching that from inside of Windows. So, and I'll show you what that looks like in a demo.
I'm curious.
Yeah.
So I run Emacs on Windows.
Yeah.
So when I go into a shell, it's giving me some kind of Bash. Emacs, how would that compare to this Bash?
So I think the Bash that is running in Windows is not. I don't think it's going to give you the full operating system. I think there's some. I don't know where the lines were drawn, but there's some limitations to what you have. It does have pre-installed a bunch of the tools and stuff. But I don't know where the actual lines are, what you can and can't do. It's not a full-blown Ubuntu 16.4 image that they're dumping on the desktop. You can get that, and you can run it on Windows 10, but to get that full image, you have to run it in Hyper-V. You know, as a virtual machine running it in Hyper-V, you can do that. Okay. So PowerShell. You know, I mentioned earlier in kind of the opening remarks that PowerShell on Linux, or PowerShell in general, was released to open source, and there's also a PowerShell for Linux. And there are a number, we could go to the GitHub and look, but there's a whole bunch of numbers of people that are contributing to PowerShell. It is growing massively since Microsoft published it fully to open source. Now, it's not like we published some pieces of PowerShell to open source and we're holding back the core or anything like that. And that's not the case. We released PowerShell to the open source, but what ended up happening is we have so many people that are contributing to PowerShell that a lot of the people that were actually writing PowerShell, their primary job now is, you know, fielding pull requests. So the internal structure of the organization has kind of changed a little bit. They've got some people that are dedicated to those really hard things that are coming in as feature requests. The things that the community wants to do, they have a dedicated group that just kind of goes through those pull requests and looks through and makes sure it's not going to break things and, you know, sends feedback if it's something that needs to change or whatever. So it's really become a monster of a business in the open source space for PowerShell. You know, it's great for existing PowerShell users, so they can use it on any system. The management products, a lot of the management products use PowerShell, so that enables those capabilities on Linux or other platforms as we move forward. Application developers, huge capabilities from scalability, automation, working with heterogeneous automation and configuration capabilities, whether it's across Windows or Linux. So just tons of capability built into this. And obviously for Linux users, PowerShell is really, really good at stuff like JSON files, managing CSV, XAML, REST APIs, and object models. It is a command line, but it's an object-based command line. So it gives you very robust, not just text commands that you run. It's all object-based. For those that want to dive in a little bit deeper, I do have a lab guide. And I've got a blog post just to make it easy. It's on my blog. It's on the first page still, but if you wait too long, it might fall to the second page. You can just do a search on step by step. It'll be one of the top ones in there for now. And this is a hands-on lab that will walk you through actually setting up Docker on Windows. It'll walk you through labs of installing Nano in a Docker container. And it doesn't, you don't even have to have the machines to do it, because you can actually go to the hands-on lab, and they'll actually build out systems for you to run all these labs on. And I've got the URL in the blog post. I've also got it in the deck here, as well as a direct link to the labs here. If anybody wants to take a picture of that, you'll get the labondemand.com URL that takes you right to the login page or the sign-up page. And it is free. There's no charge to go through it, and it'll teach you all of that stuff, kind of really step-by-step with hands-on lab guides. So let's look a little bit deeper into Docker and how that plays into our ecosystem. What I want to do is, I want to take kind of a different approach whenever I talk about containers, because I want to compare it to technologies that we're probably already aware of. Let me start this by saying Docker is not going to make any of these other technologies go away anytime soon, if ever. Right? It's just not there. Docker is for a specific purpose, and it is a very different purpose for these other capabilities like VMs and VDI and stuff like that. But what I do want to do on this slide is I want to compare session-based computing versus VM or VDI-based computing. Session-based computing, if you don't know, that's terminal services. That's where you have a whole bunch of users log in. On the server, you have your hardware, you have almost certainly have your virtualization layer there. Maybe it's going to do some of your management, maybe it doesn't have to be virtualized though. You have an operating system on top of that, and then you have all your applications and stuff on there. One operating system, users connect to it, all the users get all of the resources available to them with one operating system. That is session-based computing. Now, if we look at that, all users see and access the same OS, the CPU, the memory, the apps, etc. There really is no overhead. So on a on a decent box, you could get say you have a 12 core with 64 gig of memory, or maybe even 128 gig of memory. Some fast drives, you could easily get 500 plus users on there, right? You could get a lot of users on a decent sized box. That each user is really a workload. That's the way I look at it, each user is a workload. You can get a lot of workloads on that one piece of hardware. In a VM or VDI is virtual desktop infrastructure. That's where users log into a dedicated VM that's spun up for them. And I lump those together because they really are the same. Just VDI is one user, VM is one workload. It's not necessarily a user, okay? But VDI is the workload of a user. And in this scenario, you still have your hardware, you still have your virtualization, you still have your base operating system. But then on top of that, you have another full operating system. And inside of that, you have all your applications. And a lot of times, those applications and operating systems are exactly the same across different VMs. Maybe they run different versions. Maybe they run the same because you need additional resources. Maybe they're completely different, right? So there's lots of different options there. But the reality is, if you look at this, that same machine is not going to run the same number of workloads because you have a lot of overhead. The OS, you have many copies of the OS. What's the OS doing, particularly if it's Windows, and if not doing anything? Answer, a lot, right? It's doing a lot. And you have that not one time, but one time for each workload, for each VM, or for each VDI session. Plus you have the apps, you have the config, you have the management. Each app and workload, you do have good isolation though. So you have, in the session-based computing, you really have no isolation. The only isolation you get out of it is the isolation that you get by, maybe applying group policy settings or some other security that you might be applying to the machine. When it really comes down to it, though, there's a massive overhead. Think about it from the terms of disk I/O, right? These operating systems, these apps are always writing to disk. They take up a lot more space whenever you deploy them. And I know there's some things you can do to minimize that or to lessen that. But the reality is you still have all those operating systems. You still have all those processes running that are hitting the disk. You have all that CPU that's running all the time. You have the licensing, everything that works, right? There's a lot of overhead to that environment. I'm going to contrast this with containers. So we've learned about session-based computing, we've learned about VDI. Now let's see how that compares and contrasts to to containers. Well, in containers, you have, very much like a VM, you have hardware, virtualization, operating system, but then you have another virtualization component, and that is your container engine. On top of your container engine, you have a piece, you have what I'm going to call a base image or a container. Okay? And on top of that base image, you can add any number of containers. Each one of those containers have a workload in them. That workload can be different. There is isolation for each application. There's isolation for each container. Okay, so you have better security than you have for session-based computing, but you have all the advantages of session-based computing because you don't have to have a new operating system for each workload. Right? So you get all the advantages of session-based computing, including some isolation per container that you don't have in session-based computing. And if we draw this out a little bit further, on that same piece of hardware, on that same operating system, you could put on that same container image, you could have different base images, right? You could have a different version of Windows, a different version of the .NET framework that you want to use on it, whatever. You could have different changes to that base image, and then each one of those could have containers stacked on top of those. Take it one step further, that same piece of hardware could stand up a VM. You know, assuming that that's a Windows Server VM, Windows Server host box, stand up a Linux VM, add your Docker, add your container image, add your container base, add your containers, right? You get a lot more flexibility with containers than you do, because again, now you're looking at one OS each platform instead of one OS each workload, okay? So you get all the advantages of VM and session-based computing, including isolation with very, very little overhead. What is your overhead? It's the container image and the container base. The container engine and the container base. That's really your overhead. Now, there are some disadvantages too, and I'm not going to go into a lot of detail about what those are, but I think you'll be able to figure those out. I'll just tell you right up front, one of them is, like right now, there are enormous amounts of containers available to download. They're just free to download. They're just like if you were to use apt-get or curl to download something, you can download them from Docker Hub. But right now with Windows, there's some limitations, like there's no operating system with a GUI. The only thing you can download from Windows containers right now is Server Core and Nano Server, which again, we'll talk a little more about later. But why would anybody want to do containers? Why would vendors want to do containers? So a quick story, I used to be an engineer for a company called Sales Logix, and they're a CRM implementation company, right? We sometimes would have million-dollar jobs to go out and configure somebody's systems for customer relationship management, for billing, for help desk, for ticketing, for defects. You name it, it's like runs the whole business. And it would take months, sometimes better than a year, to deploy one of these stations because even a demo environment would take weeks to set up. That's thousands of dollars to set up. That same company could dump all that stuff in a container and a user, a potential customer or prospect could just download it and start playing with it, right? That thousands of dollars of service that's required up front for them to just get a demo is gone. Right? It's now free. So it gives them more opportunities to bring in customers. Take products like RStudio, right? RStudio is available in a container. Download it for free. Right? Start playing with it, start using it. You're gonna find it's a great platform for running your R scripts. And boom, you become a customer. How easy was it? It took me, less than 5 minutes to download it in a container. Not only that, with containers, from a continuous deployment standpoint, if you stand something up in a container and you move it, say, from development to production, it's going to be exactly the same because you don't have issues with, cross-link DLLs or DLLs that are not included in the package or any of that kind of crap because the container is everything. It's the entire environment. So there's just a huge amount of advantages to containers. So let's look at how containers run. I think this is my last slide on containers. You have the hardware, you have the hypervisor, you have the operating system, as I mentioned before. You can run a virtual machine on that. You can run Windows Server containers, which is just a service that's running in the host, in the operating system, the host operating system, that gives you that server container capability. You can run another VM that's running in hypervisor, a hypervisor with nested virtualization to run Hyper-V containers inside of that. You can run another VM that's running Windows Server in a VM instead of running it on the host operating system. You can run a virtual machine. It could be Linux or Windows. Run Docker Engine, literally the Docker engine, not one of the Microsoft Docker engines, and then run your containers on top of that. Obviously, I'm showing one container, but this could scale to many. You can run Hyper-V containers right on top of the hypervisor on your host. And lastly, we have Azure containers, Azure Container Service, which Azure abstracts all the hardware and operating system stuff and offers it as a service. So that's a platform as a service offering for containers. And Windows containers run on Windows 10 and Nano Server. So any questions before we move off from containers? Yes?
If you have containers with a bunch of CRM type applications, where does your SQL Server fit into that? Would you share your SQL Server or put it one per container?
You could do it. So the question was, how do you manage the, like if you have a CRM application, where would SQL Server go? There's a number of ways to do it. You could have it inside the container, but if you want to get more real-time performance, like you're going to get out of a multi-VM or multi-container environment, or you want that full isolation, you don't want them to run in one memory space or one kernel space, you could stand them up in separate containers, or even in separate VMs. So you could stand up a VM that's running SQL, or you can stand up a container that has SQL Server deployed inside that container. So you could do it either way, however you prefer. Other questions?
What would be the performance issue if you ran SQL Server on the main host, not in the DLL?
I mean, if you're going to hit it with 10,000 people, I wouldn't necessarily do it because SQL needs a lot of power. Obviously, you're not going to want to do that if you've got another 100 workloads on it. So it really is going to be based on how much horsepower you have on the host. If you've got nothing else but those two or three applications running on a host, if you could normally run those on one host and three VMs, no issues. You're going to have the performance to do it. Because there's actually less overhead to containers than there are to VMs. But, again, you could have issues where, you want to run multiple versions of SQL Server and just change in your configuration to point to those different servers. You do that all in one, right? It really opens up capabilities for you to do a lot more than what you did. I shouldn't say a lot more, a much easier to deploy much easier than what you could otherwise running in a virtual machine. Because you could do all that in a virtual machine too. Okay, other questions? So one question that comes up a lot is, are there applications that can't run in a container? Absolutely. You wouldn't run like Exchange Server in a container. I actually don't think it'll run, it's definitely not supported. Running anything that is a desktop GUI on the Windows platform is not supported today. Will it be a year from now? I hope so, because the container technology is brand new. We don't have that base image to apply with the GUI.
Would we be able to do that indirectly through kernel services?
No, and the problem with that is you can't deploy terminal services on Server Core or Nano. They're not available options because they need the full .NET framework, and Nano and Server Core only support .NET. Actually, Server Core, I think, does support more than the .NET Core. Nano only supports .NET Core, so it doesn't have any of the graphical user interface stuff. So from a virtualization standpoint, you can run Hyper-V inside of a virtual machine, so you can have that nested virtualization. But within that configuration, you would have to run the session-based computing on the VM, not inside the Docker container. So a little bit about Nano. So Nano is, think of Nano as like a minimalist version of your Linux distribution, right? It's a command line operating system with limited capabilities and a very, very, very small footprint. a very, very, very secure footprint, okay? And when we look at Nano Server, there's different installation options. When we look at Windows Server, there's different installation options. I just want to go through those three very quickly to kind of highlight the differences. You have RDS Experience, literally that's your terminal services, which is what we refer to as the full GUI, or it's for the specialized workloads where you need the full GUI. And then you have Server Core, which the setup time is about 300 seconds, the boot time is about 85 seconds, the disk space is 5.4 gigabytes. Your RDS, anybody know how much footprint it takes to run Windows Server full GUI?
I don't know, 16.
Yeah, the minimum I think is like 10 or 12 gigabytes. It's big, right? It's
really
big.
Or disk space?
Sorry.
Is that RAM or
disk space? RAM is probably 4 gig would be the least you'd want to run anything on. But when we look at Server Core, it's 5.4 gig. So it's half the size of the full. You don't get as much capabilities, you have a much smaller footprint, you have a smaller patch print. But Nano, look at this, the setup time is 35 seconds, the boot time, 9 seconds, right? Boot, blink a couple times and your machine is up and running, literally, it's that fast. Okay, not only that, but it's less than half a gigabyte in size. You know those 1 gig sticks that we all throw away because they don't support anything, you can't put anything on them? They would support 2 copies of Nano. That's how small Nano is. It is tiny.
Is it when you're talking DOS shell or PowerShell?
PowerShell, yeah. It's all PowerShell based. So the first question that people usually ask is, how do I manage it? Right? Because some of the problems that we had with Server Core were people didn't really understand how to manage it because maybe they weren't PowerShell proficient, or actually they weren't command line proficient with Server Core. Well, we completely fixed that because it's very easy to get your IP address from the console in Nano, and you can manage it remotely. Who uses a keyboard or a KVM to connect to all their servers, all your servers? Wow, 2 people in the room, okay. Most people don't do that way anymore. Most people remote into their servers anyway for management. And all the same tools that you use today for managing your servers will work in Nano. So whether it's PowerShell, it's your computer management tools, your system center configuration, system center management tools, your server manager, all of the tools that we've been using will still work. Even if you're using Hyper-V Manager, Server Manager, Failover Cluster Manager, Perfmon, all of that stuff still works to manage Nano, quite simply. Nano has a different way of deploying. So it's not a direct deploy off of sticking a Windows DVD and booting to it. You have to create an image for it. And you do that, there's a Nano Server folder on the image, on the Windows Server image that you can use to run an image builder. You select basically the components, because the way Nano is built is you have the Nano Core, right? It has nothing but Core on there, and then you decide what services you want to deliver in Nano. So if you don't need DNS on there, you don't have to patch DNS. You don't have to have that extra footprint or that extra security hole that could potentially be there by adding DNS or adding IIS or whatever. But if you want those capabilities, you can add them here whenever you do the deployment, and then it will create the image. It can create either a VHD for you to deploy in your virtualization environment, or it can create a USB thumb drive to actually boot a physical server on. Now, before I move off of this, I just want to share one other thing. I know in a Linux world, you don't do installs of features like this, right? You're doing an apt-get, or you're doing a curl, or you use a command line to do installs. Guess what? In Nano, they give you this for deployment, but you can use command line with PowerShell commands, just like your apt-get, not the same command, or just like your curl, where it's going to download that image off the web. If you don't want to do that, you can download them locally, place them locally, and then point to that target. So if your server's, say, not connected to the internet, which is probably the best practice, you can still use those options as well. But works just like Linux, where you can download the features that you want right off the web. So let's dig into Docker just a little bit. What time do we go to? I want to make sure I leave plenty of time for demo.
We generally go to around 9.
Okay.
But since we're not going to go to the brewery afterwards, you'd take longer.
Okay. I actually was thinking I'll want to get you guys out of here a little bit earlier, being as the holidays are close. We'll see how it goes. I'm actually almost done with slides anyway. So I do want to talk about a few tools. The Docker tools. Who understands Docker commands? Okay, only a couple people in the room. So I was telling Jerry earlier before anybody got here, I'd be happy to come in and do kind of a Docker hands-on lab for you guys when you have your kind of monthly or every 2 weeks, whenever it is, whenever you have your hands on. Happy to come in and do that if you guys are interested in doing that. But the Docker machine is a utility provision Docker host. Okay, it's a command prompt, a command line utility. All Docker is really command line access. But you have your Docker engine. That's the engine that sits on top of your operating system that actually manages. Docker is not a virtualization platform. Docker didn't invent containers. Containers were around long before Docker came around. Docker is simply a company that came up with a better way to manage containers. So Docker is a container management company, and the Docker product is their management product. So I really want you to look at it that way. Docker is not your container containerization platform. They're leveraging the platform of Windows. They're leveraging the platform of Ubuntu or CentOS or Red Hat or whatever. They're leveraging the container services that are built into those operating systems, and they're allowing you a management interface to very easily manage all of those images and download additional images. So like Apple made a ton of money off the Apple Store and made their Apple phone and their iPads and all that stuff really, really popular, Docker did the same thing. They created that store for images, and it's gone through the roof. So there's a Docker client that can be installed that allows you to interact directly with the Docker engine. There's Docker Compose, which Compose is a way of orchestrating multiple things to happen from in Docker. So in the case you talked about earlier about having a CRM where you have multiple containers that you want to deploy to, your Docker Compose would actually allow you to stand up those multiple containers and get them all working together. So that's the component that would actually do that. Your Docker Hub is online, hub.docker.com. That's the public repo, or the public store, if you will, of all the Docker containers that are out there. Docker Swarm is it clusters your Docker host or your Docker machines to allow you to automatically scale out, to automatically deploy, and to not really have to care about which machine your new Docker container is going on. It will manage that for you. So it takes your entire cluster of Docker hosts and it exposes them as a single host. So you could have 5, you could have 30 different hosts, but whenever you're deploying, you just deploy to one, and it will, the Docker Swarm will decide which host is the best one to put it on based on resources, workload, etc. And then Docker Data Center's on-premise management, managed container solution. We're not going to go into detail on that. But I do want to look a little bit at the Docker file. Docker file is a file, or configuration file. I know you Linux guys you understand what configuration files look like. It's simply a configuration. These are some of the instructions you can put in there. From, environment, copy, add, expose. I'm not going to go into a lot of detail on these, just to let you know that they're all there. And you can read the slide or you can do some more research on it. But you, inside the Docker file, you configure all the stuff that makes up your Docker container. And then you can use that Docker file to issue a command to the Docker engine to go build that Docker container for you. So it can all be scripted very, very easily. And this is how, the Docker file is actually how we do a lot of continuous integration, a lot of continuous deployment and stuff like that. So when you look at a lot of the companies that do CI and CD, they're all leveraging this kind of technology. When you look at organizations that are deploying services, they have these standard images that they use. They create their own private repo for their own images that they've got their own applications, their own configurations already set. And then they configure all that through the Docker files, so they can just republish to another, make another one anytime that they want, or move it to another destination. So you want it to move from AWS to Azure. That makes it really easy to do because they both understand the same Docker file, because it's all the same across all platforms. So I told you earlier I was going to tell you a little bit more about the Microsoft Linux story and how we came down this road of becoming really selling out to Linux and the open source community. And this was an article put out by Fortune, talking about Microsoft and the reasons investors like Microsoft. I don't know if you guys have been watching Microsoft, but in the last year and a half, stocks like almost tripled. It's just been going through the roof. And a lot of the reason for that is some of the decisions that we've made, that the company has made, and in particular, Satya Nadella is driving this, where you probably saw this slide, Microsoft loves Linux, and Satya Nadella saying that better than a year and a half ago, shortly after he took over the company. He is our new CEO, if you didn't know. He replaced Ballmer. Under the Ballmer regime, Ballmer was a finance guy. He was originally a bean counter. So for him, he was more involved with making products that he could sell for top dollar. Right? That was his real mission in life. Satya Nadella, when he came in, his background was as an engineer. So he wanted to help drive innovation within by leveraging the resources that he had at his disposal in Microsoft. I mean, you're talking 100,000 plus employees, leverage that power to really drive innovation. And look at some of the things that they've done. You've got all the stuff that's happening with Azure. That was all Satya's baby long before he came to CEO. He is the one that drove Azure and made Azure a product. And he's taken that same innovation that he put into Azure and is now driving it into the rest of the company. To the point now where every product has to be PowerShell enabled. Every product, because that is our cross-platform solution for managing things. They want people to be able to manage their Windows systems from inside a Linux machine, as an example, right? So they want to have that cross-platform compatibility across the board. He's driving everybody in the organization to develop for Linux, right? So, Linux is so far, Microsoft has been a fan or been engaged with Linux for years. I mean, I remember working with Linux on Windows NT 4, right? We had these extensions that allow you to manage or work with, communicate with Linux. But you know what? That was so childish. That was kind of, Linux is an afterthought. Oh, let's put these tools out there, right? Now, Linux is so far behind Microsoft in the development inside the Microsoft ecosystem that Satya said, look, we got to do Linux first, right? Forget this, pretty stuff that we've been working on. We need to nail down the command line. We need to nail down interoperability first, and that means whenever you put out a new product, it needs to run on Linux, right? You need to develop that product for Linux. So what are we seeing? We're seeing SQL Server now runs on Linux. We're seeing PowerShell runs on Linux. We're seeing the open source stuff like Visual Studio Code. And as we release more and more products, you're going to see more and more stuff that's coming out on Linux, because Satya is sold on Linux is a first-class citizen. And let me share one other thing this is kind of an internal story, if you will, about how Microsoft culture has changed as it relates to the way Satya is running things. Under Steve Ballmer, we employees were evaluated on how we do against our peers. So it's called stack ranking, right? Anybody use stack ranking in their company today? I usually get one or two hands. It's a very painful way to be evaluated. So in a stack ranking environment, it doesn't matter what you do. It doesn't matter what your peers do. It only matters what you do relative to others at your same level. So if you're a superstar, that's great. If you're not a superstar, that's not great. because you're not going to be the one that gets the bonus. And oh, by the way, if you're not in the top, if you're not in the top 80%, you're not going to have a job next month or next year, right? Because that's the way it worked. If you fall to the bottom of the scale, you're out. If you're on the top of the scale, you're golden. If you're in the middle of the scale, you're not golden, and this is why. Say you have somebody that's a high performer, right? They do really good at, you know, some or all aspects of their job. Everybody else has the attitude, why should I bother? I'm never going to catch Dan. I'm never going to catch Carl, right? Why should I even bother? And you have people, even worse, I have my peers coming to me and saying, Dan, slow down. We can't keep up with you, man. Just chill. You don't have to do that much, right? So I have my peers within Microsoft holding me back. I'm assuming that I'm a high performer. I'm just making that up, okay? So whatever. Believe what you want to believe. What ends up happening is it takes innovation capabilities away, and it takes drive from high performers, and it takes that out of the game because, you know, they're being pulled back by others. Under Satya, we're being evaluated in a completely different way. We're being evaluated on how much we're able, 30% of our score comes from how much we're able to help other people. Right? What have we done to help drive innovation throughout other pieces, not our team, other parts of the Microsoft company? 30% is on how much we have used of other people's, how much we have leveraged other people's work, and 30% is how much of our work has been leveraged by other people. Right. So instead of now everybody,
you fell short of the 10%.
I did, and there's another 10%, and the other 10% is on your personal achievements, and that is subjective based on your boss's opinion, right? So there's, your boss has some say. It's not all about the numbers when it comes to your evaluation. So individual performance is still important, trivial compared to helping others and allowing others to help you, or having others contribute to the work that you're doing, make your work better. If you think about that from purely a culture standpoint, he's driving into our organization to everybody work together, everybody help everybody, or you're going to be the one out the door, right? So it's a very different culture than it was under Ballmer. And you're seeing the results of that, you know, in the numbers on Wall Street for Microsoft stock. All of that is stuff that Satya's done in the last 2.5 years that he's been our leader. I lied to you. There are a couple more slides. So this one is a book I strongly recommend that everybody reads. If you have heard anything about DevOps, you've probably heard about this book. It's a must-read, The Phoenix Project. It is. It really tells you in a story the importance of DevOps and what is DevOps. It is not necessarily a technical manual, but it goes through an organization that is dysfunctional, and it shows how to turn that organization into a high-performing organization by way of implementing DevOps practices. So very, very cool, very, very engaging story. The first couple chapters are a little slow. Don't skip them. They're important to the dialogue as you move forward. And if there's some characters in there that you really like, that you feel like they're getting the short end of the stick, don't sweat it. They probably are going to get a better end of the stick at the end of the book. So really important book. I encourage everybody to read that. The best part of it, it's available in audiobook. And if you don't have an Audible account already, you can get it for free, because when you sign up for a new Audible account, you get 2 free books with it. So I encourage everybody to do that. Azure Open Cloud. I mentioned earlier, like 60-70% of all the stuff that's running in Azure is running on Linux. But it's not just Linux, you know. It's Xamarin. We just purchased Xamarin. And you know, guess what? The Xamarin API was made open source almost immediately, right? Again, going into, let's get this stuff open source, right? Xamarin was making a lot of money. That's where the money came from, right? Now it's all open source. You have Puppet, SaltStack, Scalar, obviously Docker Swarm, Drupal, you know, WordPress. When you get into infrastructure, you got Red Hat, SUSE, Bitnami, Oracle running in Azure, right? Supported in Azure on Linux. So just really, Microsoft has really dived in deep into the pool when it comes to open source and supporting open source. I do have a bunch of great resources on here as well at the end of the deck, but let's dive into looking at some of this stuff in action. Any questions first?
Whatever happened to Iron Python? Most people who are not already excited about Windows and .NET, I know, have never been interested in PowerShell, but if you went Python way into your APIs, they might be more interested.
Python is not a Microsoft product, so I'm not sure what angle you're...
Well, I mean, you're promoting PowerShell as the way to manage your stuff and so on. I just...
Well, no, it's just a Microsoft tool.
Yeah, but you'd do better in the broader program community if you offered options for people who want to use Python instead.
We do. Yeah, in fact, I'm going to show you that right now.
Oh.
We absolutely do. PowerShell, the question was, what about Python or other tools to use for management? And in fact, if you look at GitHub, where there's integration with Azure, just search on the word Azure and Python, you'll see tons of examples of how Python scripts are being created and they're leveraging either the Azure CLI or PowerShell under the covers. Most of them are using the CLI right now because the PowerShell thing is brand new. But yeah, their Python, all of those capabilities are available in Python via the Azure CLI. And we see that even the stuff that we're developing for our customers, like when we're, people in my role are often out helping customers figure out, how to solve their problems and deploy solutions to help them get to where they want to be. Python is often a language of choice. So I was working with a customer just last month where they built their entire, onboarding process, their entire continuous integration process and continuous deployment process on a Python app, right? And that becomes the web front end to all this other orchestration that's happening under the covers, right? So the user, they used a Python app so that their user could go and say, I need a new virtual machine for this, I want it to be this size, I want it to be in this, location, I need this much memory, I need this many hard drives. They fill out the form, hit submit, boom, done. Returns once it builds that machine, usually 5-6 minutes later, it builds that machine and it returns them. One of the things they have to enter is their username and password, unless there's another case where we could do a certificate if they wanted to do that. But then it returns the IP address and they already know their username and password because they supplied that whenever they built that infrastructure out. So yeah, Python is very much a member of the open source community that we're supporting and and even evangelizing as we do projects ourselves with our customers. So I'm in the Azure portal now, and just some things that I wanted to show you. I'm just going to go to plus here, and I'm just going to go to compute. And from inside of here, I'm going to hit see all. And there's like so many different things in here. I'm just going to scroll down for a moment and see some of them, and then we'll do a couple searches. So Ubuntu, Windows, Red Hat, SQL Server, Virtual Machine Scale Set. Virtual Machine Scale Set is, think of it as like a auto scale out cluster. Azure Container Service, that's what I talked about earlier when we talked about a container that's running containers inside of a platform as a service environment. You see a lot of customized images that people have put up there in the gallery. Different versions of Ubuntu, Visual Studio. Okay, so let's search for Python first. So Django, Data Science Virtual Machine, Gelastic, all kinds of stuff, right? These are all probably going to have Python already installed inside the image. That's why it's coming up. Okay, and then if I wanted to search on, say, Oracle, right? These are all the different images available for Oracle to run right inside of Azure. Okay, so what if we wanted to do Ubuntu? All the different versions of Ubuntu, and then we have some customized Ubuntu, like Ubuntu that already has Docker installed on it and running. Right, all fully configured. Older versions of Ubuntu as well. You know, if you have something that's done there, hardened copies of Ubuntu. Lots of stuff in there. And you notice there, each one of these has a load more. A lot of these I could sit there for like 10 clicks and keep loading more. And sometimes there are new stuff down there, and sometimes it's just, you know, different versions of stuff. But there's a lot of stuff out there. Again, a large majority of the stuff that's running in Azure is actually running on some flavor of Linux. So let's take a look at, say, Red Hat. Anything else you guys want to particularly look for? All right, Red Hat is one of our new providers. So there's not a long list of them. And this is the configuration for that. To go through, I'm going to actually, anything you guys want to look for before I go off of this, because I actually want to go build something, just to show you what that process looks like.
I wonder if you have red space hat and you find
where. Yeah, that might be what I did wrong. So plus. Compute. See how. And I could actually do it earlier, but I just want to show you the click by click Red Hat. Yeah, that's what it is. So you still have different versions, different flavors, different versions with different things already pre-installed. And see, there's not a more here. And the point that I wanted to make there, those SQL Server vNext. So the new version of SQL is not out yet. Remember I said we're being chartered to Linux first, so we can start catching up on the code base for really making Linux a first-class citizen, because we're, you know, Microsoft is so far behind, they haven't done that much Linux development over the decades. So they need to spend more time on Linux to kind of help get caught up to where the Windows client is. So it truly is a first class client. So even the next version of SQL is already out on Red Hat Enterprise Linux. So I'm going to go back to Ubuntu and notice that I can run Docker on Ubuntu server, but I'm just going to go ahead and do a standard Ubuntu just to walk you through that process of what it looks like to run this on Azure. So I'm going to do it in a resource manager, and a resource manager just says what model do I want to use. There's two different models. The resource manager is the new model. The other one is service model, and you wouldn't really do anything on that because that whole model is going away eventually. So I give it a name, so BLU 12 21. Let's try that. And I'm going to do I want to do SSDs or do I want to do spinning disks? I'm going to do spinning disks. I'm going to set a username. It's called Azure Admin. I could use a SSH key, you know, generate from Putty or wherever, or you can actually even generate it from Azure. You can have Azure generate a key for you. I'm just going to use a password for now. And I'm going to give it a standard password. More subscription, I have many. You'll generally only have probably one or two. And the resource group, do I want to create a new or do I want to use an existing? I'm going to create a new one. Actually, no, I'm going to use an existing one because I already have one that I created for BLU demo. Okay. And I'm going to say okay to that. So this is going to spin up a new machine. And what size of the machine do I want it to be? I'm going to go up to you all and make it a D2. I just want to do two. instead of playing with them, I'm just going to make it a D1. So this is a one core, 3.5 gigabytes, two data disks, and you know, it includes the load balancer and etc. So I can select a storage, or I can have it auto create storage for me. In this case, it auto selected the storage that I used for my prior machine, I think. It created VNet, created an IP address, also created a public IP address for me, okay, and a public DNS name. I can add extensions if I want to. So some of those extensions are like Chef, Puppet, or you know, custom script or whatever. Right? These are some other extensions. Acronis Backup, you can add those. So I'm going to not add those now. And you can enable or disable monitoring as part of your image. And if you're going to enable it, you need storage to put your monitoring on. So I'm going to go ahead and say OK. I have completely configured it. Validation has passed, so I can just run. 6 minutes later, that will be done. Okay. In the meantime, I'm going to go back to the machine that I created earlier today, like while you guys were watching me, while you guys were talking. And I created this machine and show you what that looks like. So the first thing it's going to do whenever you pop up the box is it's going to say, you've never connected to this host. Do you want server's host key? It's not cached. Are you sure that you want to connect to this and download the server's key? Yes. Okay, so I'm going to log in as Azure Admin. Oh. And I am on my Ubuntu machine. Okay. If I do cd slash etc, you'll see that I'm on a Ubuntu 16 server. So you access it the same way you would any Linux box through SSH. If I were to go and install, let me go to my blog. I have on my blog how to Docker create container, change image, etc. So on this, I actually walk you through the process of installing Docker. So sudo curl to install Docker, and then I refer you to the documentation as well. And then I talk to you a little bit about the basic commands of Docker if you want to kind of get used to it or you want to learn about it. And then I actually walk you through some of the definitions of some of the things we've already talked about today, but maybe a little bit more detail on images and PS. In fact, I probably will go into that a little bit. And then I do a step-by-step, okay? So if I wanted to run an Ubuntu container, I could simply run this command. So if I go to, I'm going to go to, I think I have Docker on this machine. Okay, so I'm going to just paste this. Docker run IT Ubuntu latest bin bash. So what this is saying is I want to run, actually let me do one other thing first. Let me just do Docker info. So by doing Docker info, I'm showing you the Docker is running on this machine, so I have a Docker engine running on Windows. Okay? So whenever I run this command, Docker run, what it's actually going to do, is not really good with my mouse on this laptop. So Docker run says run a command to the Docker engine. The command you want to run is run, which basically means it's going to run a container. IT means it's going to be interactive. So it's going to leave me at the inside of the virtual machine, or inside of the container. The container that I want to run is Ubuntu latest, and the command that I want to run inside that virtual machine to leave me at is bin bash. Right, so it's going to run a bash command inside of the Docker container. Now you'll see a couple things. It happened automatically. Okay? Instantly it happened. Why is that? Because I already have a container on this machine called Ubuntu latest. In other words, I've already downloaded it. So if I look, you know, I'm inside of my Ubuntu container now. And if I run Docker, Docker not found. Why? Right, because Docker is never installed inside the container. That is literally an isolated environment, okay, from my local machine. So I'm going to go ahead and exit out of this, and I'm going to run a couple of other commands. So I'm going to run Docker PS. So Docker PS lists the containers that are running on this machine. Oh wow, there's no containers running. Why is that? Because I exited bash, which exited the container. Docker's smart enough to know that that container is not needed anymore because everybody exited out of it. So it automatically shut the container down. But it's still there. So if I do Docker ps-all, thank you. Actually, dash A will do it as well. You'll see all the containers that I have running on this machine. You'll see I have an Ubuntu latest. I actually have two of them. You know, and the last one was run a minute ago. Okay, so that was the one that we had logged into. So these containers are running, but where are they running? Where are they running? They're on my local machine, but my local machine is Windows 10. You guys already saw that, right? So where they're running is, I have this Mobi Linux VM. That is my Docker engine. That is running Ubuntu 16.4. That is where they're running. They're running inside of that VM, so those containers are being spun up inside of that VM. Remember my diagram where I showed you how you can deploy, right? This is that last one on the far right where I'm deploying on Windows in a virtual machine, running Linux, running the Docker engine inside of that. That's the deployment option I've used for this particular machine. Lots of different options. That's just the one that I'm using for here. Because that's the easiest way to get it on Windows 10. So I've installed the client. Whenever I installed the client, that gave me the engine also. And the way it works is creating this Mobi Linux VM. Any questions? So the next thing I want to show you is Docker image. Images, and you'll see that I have three images. So what's the difference between an image and a container? So a container doesn't run. Sorry, an image does not run. A container runs. So really the difference between an image and a container is a container is a running copy of the image. It is not a running image. Okay? So whenever you create an image, you can create a container off of that image. And whenever you build that out, any number of containers can be stacked on top of each other. In fact, if you want to go a little bit deeper, I can. You know, I have some slides to kind of visualize that. But as you're adding stuff, so let me go back to my blog for just a moment. So in this blog, you'll see some things that I've done. So I've showed you how to install Docker on it. I've done an apt-get and an apt-curl, apt-get-install install curl. So you can see that process, and then I exited. And I show you how to look at the last image, sudo docker ps-i, which is, says show me the last image that I created. And I'll talk you how to get the container ID, and then I can commit. So docker commit says, take this container that I've just made changes to, commit it to another container. So containers stack on top of each other to make other containers. So I have, once I do this commit, I'll still have my Ubuntu latest image, but I'll now have a new one called Ubuntu base. And then Ubuntu Base is already going to have my apt-get for curl already installed. Okay? As I add additional components, and if you look down, as I go further down here, I'm using Ubuntu Base. I'm just logging into it to say which curl. So I can show you that I'm re-logging into that container, that new container called Base that has curl installed. But I wanted to go a little bit further and show you a few other things. You can add the Docker user, so it's an admin user with that command. And let's go a little bit further. Let's do an install of Xubuntu Desktop. Right? Now I'm running a full desktop inside of a container on Ubuntu. And after I do that, I'm going to go and install XRDP, set some session, do the output so that my session is defined. And then I'm going to save that. I'm going to do a commit of that image to Ubuntu 16:RDP. That's my tag of RDP. Now I have three different images. I have my latest, I have my base, and I have my RDP. I can start with any one of those and build out more. Right? So I can start with my base and build out my Python server. Right? I can start with base and build out my Docker registry or my other Docker or my whatever, my node, right? My J2E servers or containers or whatever. I can start with anywhere to build those things out. I could start building those out on my RDP if I want and make yet other containers on top of that. This is the thing. If you run any container that has a predecessor of another container, you have to have all of those containers available because it runs on top of all of those. This is where it gets really, really, really cool. The container you're running in, any Docker container is running in such a way as it's called copy on write. So other than the highest level container, it will never write to that container. If it tries to write to something like, say, you have say you have Python installed in there and you want to change some of your configuration files for Python, you can still get to those files, but whenever it writes it, it's not going to write it to the Python container. That container is locked. It's sealed. You get the raw Python from when Python was installed. The changes that you make are going to be in that higher level container, right? So you can still use your Python base image for 15 other containers that 15 other programs are using. I'm working on a client with a client now who's using WebSphere, and we're literally going to be deploying multiple websites, and that WebSphere is going to be our base container, right? Base container, WebSphere, not configured even, right? That's my base, no configuration whatsoever. And then whenever I install my applications, I'm going to create different containers for each of my websites that are going to run on WebSphere. What's running under the covers is one copy of WebSphere with all those containers sitting on top of it, right? Very, very, very cool technology, very portable, because as long as you have the entire container chain, you can run it on any Docker system. Make sense? Questions? So what do you guys think of this technology? All right, so let me, let's see, there's a couple other things I wanted to show you. Microsoft fortifies commitment to open source, becomes Linux Foundation Platinum member. Why? Why would Microsoft become a Platinum member? I think I kind of went over this in pretty good detail already. But the reality is, under Satya Nadella, Microsoft wants Linux to be a first-class citizen. But just as importantly, Microsoft is already contributing to the Linux code base through GitHub repos. So why not? Why not dive in and make it official and start that process of really making Linux a first-class citizen within the Microsoft ecosystem? And that's really kind of what it's all about. Platinum member. CodeChip. This is just another example of a CI integration, right? We're working with CodeChip now, an open source startup, I guess you could say, where they are a CI integration platform. Continuous integration, continuous deployment. So we're working with them now to have, we're building out the script so you can deploy directly to Azure. And their system is set, so you know, if you've got stuff running in AWS, you can just change your deployment. Instead of running to AWS, run to Azure. Same exact code, everything is exactly the same, user just has to change the destination to Azure, right? They have the same thing with DigitalOcean, the same thing with Google, same thing with a bunch of other platforms, right? So people can very easily migrate workloads all built on Docker. The reason they can do this is it's all built on Docker. It doesn't matter where you deploy it. It's all just Docker. Anybody runs Docker the same because it's all the same API. Very, very cool technology. And they're not the only ones. I mean, look at Jenkins, right? Everybody knows about Jenkins and what they're doing, right? Lots of companies are out there leveraging the power of containers and Docker to you know, really change the world. Let's see, I have a couple other things I wanted to chat about. Did that one. Oh, the download Nano Server Builder. Again, it's going to be on the Windows Server Disk too. Okay, so any questions on anything that we've talked about today? Okay, so I'm going to go talk about a few other things. Do you guys want to go early, or do you want to talk about a few other things? I'd like to cover a few other things that I scratched out because I wasn't sure if I was going to have time for. You guys okay with that?
Sure.
Another 15 minutes of PowerPoint?
Yeah.
I'm not a fan of killing you guys with PowerPoint, so. But I have all the slides available for you anyway. So what I want to talk about really is DevOps, and so what is DevOps? If you read the book, The Phoenix Project, Gene Kim and his three ways, the three ways are, the first way is system thinking, the second way is amplified feedback loops, and the third way is culture of continual experimentation and learning. That doesn't mean anything to you now if you haven't read the book. But after you read the book, you'll know that that is incredibly powerful. Because what continuous integration, what DevOps really is, it's taking technologies like continuous integration, like infrastructure as code, automated testing, application performance and monitoring and management, continuous deployment, release management, configuration management, all of these technologies, bringing them together to make things easier to manage, to make things easier to deploy, to make things easier to migrate, to take the IT burden away from us and put it on the tools. But not only that, there's so many other things that it does because it can limit your deployment time. Think of a business where, take a look at Microsoft. Microsoft, how long did Microsoft take to put out Windows 95? Anybody remember?
5 years.
Yeah, about 5 years. How about Windows XP? So actually, went from 95 to
98.
To 98
second edition to...
Second edition, we're not going to count that, because that was like...
It was like...
And it was actually even the same, it was... Disk one was identical to 98.
And then what was it, Millennium Edition?
That doesn't count either. NT was out with 95, right? That was the server product.
Windows 2000?
Yeah, Windows 2000 was next. So that was about 5 years. If you count the one in the couple in the middle, say it's 3 years. What about Vista?
It must have been like five, six years.
Yeah, 6 years, long time.
And the OEM still screwed it up with the laptops and whatnot.
Yep. What about Windows 7? How long did that take? Remember?
What was it, like 4 years?
I think it was about 3.5 years. Yeah.
Oh, from Vista.
Yeah, from Vista. It was pretty. Actually, no. I think it was three. It was really quick because there were so many complaints about Vista. And really, most of the complaints were usability and driver. They had to fix the driver issue, and then partners decided they weren't going to jump on the bandwagon because why should they? They got an $89 printer in Staples. Well, why should I write a driver for the next version of Windows when if I don't write a driver, they have to go buy a new printer from me? You know, so it just didn't make economical sense for the vendors to jump on the bandwagon. I am getting to a point here. How long did it take to create Windows 10? I think it was about 2 or 3 years, about 3 years, something like that.
Because it was like
8. How long did it take to create the next version of Windows? What was the next version of Windows?
8.
Oh, sorry, I missed 8. 8 was in there right after 7, and then 10. How long? So, after Windows 10, what was the next operating system?
There wasn't realistically. There was the anniversary update, which was essentially just, a service pack.
That is the new way Windows is deployed. Windows 10
was the last version. Yeah.
Anniversary update is actually equivalent to Windows 11. The next update after that, the next major update after that will be equivalent to Windows 12. So how do they go from a model of 3 to 6 years to a model of 18 months? They applied these practices. What can other businesses do? And that's the operating system, the hardest thing in the world to wholesale change and update. Think of it this way. Whenever you look at Azure, how often does Azure update? Azure is an operating system, right? It's an operating system in the cloud. How often do they update it? Gee, sometimes weekly. Sometimes daily. You have multiple updates in a day, right? It's happened to me. I'm in the middle of a presentation or worse, I was writing my book on the Azure certification test. I was going in there, I did all my screenshots and started writing all my stuff. I got it done, I went back just to double check everything. All the screens were completely different, right? So I rewrote it. 3 months later, they were all different again. There are some downsides, right? Things change pretty rapidly. But the upside is, we can deploy innovation in days instead of years. Days instead of years. So we're not bound to these long cycles. And by being bound to the long cycles, what does that mean? You potentially have millions of lines of code to change. What is the probability of having some compatibility issues if you have millions of lines of code change? Very, very high. Did we have problems? Absolutely, we had a ton of problems. If we're applying updates every couple months, how many lines of code are being changed? Thousands, right? Much less, maybe it's tens of thousands, much less. But this is the thing. Let's take a look at it from a slightly different standpoint. If we are, in the case of Windows prior to 10, how many different versions of, say, what was before, Windows 8, how many different versions of Windows 8 did we have?
Like, I think there was like 4 or 5 SKUs.
Add a couple of zeros to that. Why? Because every time there's a hotfix, it's a new base.
Oh, I thought you meant like SKU, so like ultimate professional.
Yeah. Yeah. So there's a few SKUs, but all kinds of different customers would have different hotfixes that some would get and some wouldn't get, and all kinds of different update versions, right? How many different customers were on different versions that Microsoft had to support? Thousands. Tens of thousands even. Right, that they had to support. And many of those were large enterprise accounts where they literally had to do regression testing against all these different copies of Windows that were out there before they could send that patch out. Or, shit's gonna break. You know it, it's gonna break, because it's too much to test. Versus the way they're doing it in Windows 10, how many different versions of Windows 10 are out there? 6, 8. Everybody's forced to do those upgrades. If you don't do the upgrades, that's okay. You're on that one that they're still supporting, right? Eventually, they're going to get to the point where they're not supporting it anymore, and you're going to have to upgrade. You know, take that next step. From a support standpoint, massive change. From the ability to get code out faster and much more reliable, huge change. That's the kind of capability you get by applying some of these practices. And it's not just Microsoft that's doing it. The whole world is doing this. Go search on the term DevOps. Go look at all the different companies that are applying DevOps and are coaching customers on applying DevOps. They're just massive. The, massive the amount of implications that we have here. Did you have a question, Ken?
Yeah, just the anti to this is how do you lock it?
So this is an interesting question. How do you lock when you have all this continuous integration and stuff? This is a little bit of a thought process change, because traditionally, I'm gonna answer that, but I'm gonna take the long way around to answer it, okay? Because I need to tell you a story. I was working with a developer on a project. I was the IT guy. This was fairly recently, like this year, this calendar year. And he was working with me on a project. I had asked him to come in and do some coding for me. I was writing some code, but I was doing like the PowerShell, some PowerShell backend, and I wanted him to do some other stuff for me. I think he was writing in. He was doing some Python stuff, and he was doing some Bash stuff. And the problem that I had was with the Bash. His Bash script wouldn't run for me. It would not run for me. So he said, you're doing something wrong. It runs fine. I've tried it on three different machines. It runs perfectly at all of my machines. Okay, so what did I do? I sent it to one of my peers on the West Coast. I said, you know, something, no shock. My machine has hiccups all the time. I believe his story that it's my machine. So I sent it to a peer on the West Coast and asked her to run it. You know, gave her the same instructions that he had given me. Exactly. Nope, doesn't run for me. So I sent it to another peer in New York. Said, can you run this? I can't get it to run on my machine, but you know, the person that's working with it now swears it works. Guess what? She couldn't run it either. So where is this thing running? Fine. On the developer's machine, and that's it. I can't deploy it anywhere else. I tried deploying it in an Azure machine. Guess what? It wouldn't run there either. So I couldn't get it to run anywhere. This is the interesting point, though. He sent it to the customer directly, and the customer was able to get it to run. Oh, great! Outstanding! At least it runs on his machine and the customer's machine. We've made progress, right? Is that repeatable? No, not repeatable. So I said, well, we got to fix this. We got to figure out why it only runs in some environments. You know what his answer was? I don't have the time. It's your problem, not mine.
Whoops,
that's a typical developer response in a lot of cases, right? This is somebody that understands DevOps, and this was somebody that's pretty smart. He just didn't have the cycles to think about it, right? So threw the pat answer at me. Your problem, not mine, right? So I made it my problem. What did I do? I rewrote his Bash script. It was a long script. Took me all weekend. I worked through the weekend to rewrite his Bash script, and I found the problem. I couldn't find it on his because, let's just say, our programming styles were very different, right? So I rewrote it in Bash. I simplified it greatly over what he produced, and actually took a lot less time than he did to actually write it. But anyway, I found the problem. The problem was the way he was calling or storing the Azure account ID variable, which is a long, you know, like 128-bit, or I think it's a 32-bit number or whatever. A long number that's got all kinds of extended characters in it and stuff. And if it had, I forget what the character was that it had. I think it was a back quote, a back tick. And then if it had a back tick or one of those weird characters in it, then it truncated the string on it. So whenever you tried to pass it to Azure, but the only time it would have a problem was if your Azure account ID had that back tick in it. So I did some additional research and whatever. I don't think it was a back tick. I can't remember what it was.
Question mark?
No, you know, it was the tilde. It was a tilde. So if it had a tilde in it, it would crash, but if it didn't have a tilde, it would work fine. So his Azure account didn't have one in it, and the customer's Azure account didn't have one in it. So I did some research. I have a bunch of Azure accounts. I have like 30 of them. I went through all of them. Every single one of mine had a tilde in it. I would not be able to get that to run any of my accounts. I did some additional research, and I found out about 80% of the Azure accounts will have that character in it. So that means 20% of them would be a pass, 80% would be a fail. Is that a way to deliver an application? Of course not, right? DevOps gives us the capability of spotting these things and narrowing down where the problems are. So it helps from a development standpoint. It helps from a deployment standpoint. And I am getting back to your question. So let's think about this for a minute. If that code would have been delivered in a container, would it have worked in my environment?
Probably, because everything's in that container, right?
No, because I still would have been connected to my Azure account. So if it was trying to do anything else in Azure, which it was, it would have failed when it tried to communicate with Azure. But what would that have done if it were running in a container? What would I know? It's not an environment problem. We would have ruled everything out. It's got to be a connectivity problem with Azure right out of the gate. The only thing that's different between my environment and his is the connectivity to Azure. It would have narrowed that down. Instead of me spending all weekend working on it, I would have known in 5 minutes if he had delivered that in a container. Because I know it's nothing else, because I got the entire container. Only thing that's different are the keys on how I'm authenticating. That's it. The only thing that's different. Let's take another situation. Let's say that you have an application, I'll just pick a company. I know they're on Azure, but I don't know if any of this story is true. I'm just kind of making it up as we go. So, Jet.com. Is it Jet? Jet. They have a website, and they have continuous innovation. If they want to, deploy new specials on their website, and maybe automatically have an email go out to alert all of their regular customers, or maybe it's Amazon, right? Or one of my favorite stores, Rockler.com, because I'm a woodworker. And they can send me alerts based on my past history, my past purchase history, and all that stuff. But how are they going to do that? What makes that happen? And oh, by the way, what has to change? If you're going to make a change like that, if you're going to have, you know, a website update to put your specials out there, do you want to get involved as IT? Do you? It's a question. Do you want to get involved? You do. Okay. Do you?
Yeah.
Who wants to be involved with that? Show of hands. Wow. Everybody. Read the book. So the moral of the story is, why do you want to be involved? You want to be involved to make sure that they don't break your stuff. Right? That's why you want to be involved. But there, as you start applying DevOps practices, there's automatic checks and balances throughout the whole process. So you could have them deploy it, or you could push the deploy button once you've tested in QA, if that's what you want to do. Right? You can leave that last step for you, but then your step is not getting all these DLLs and making sure they're in the right place and running MSIs and setting all this up and spending days working on it. It's go see the app running as, you know, in the QA slot and say, okay, switch my DNS to point to that QA slot I know it's working. Right? So you're simplifying your job a lot. Not only that, but if a problem does come up later, think about this scenario. A problem does come up later and you do have to roll back. How much work is that for the IT guy? That's a ton of work, right? That is a ton of work. What if that website includes changes that users have made since they logged in with the new site? Oh my God, what a nightmare. Weeks, months, how many nights are you going to have to be working late? Versus a developer going in and say, roll back, and it automatically flips back. All the data stays the same, automatically flips back to the prior. Or you go in and say, flip back. Change the DNS back to the old production server. All the data stored in the same place. We're talking about a different way of looking at things. And the old rules don't apply. You can apply rules. You can apply security. You can. All I'm asking you to do is keep an open mind. Read the book. Keep an open mind, because we've always done things that way because other people that play with our systems have always screwed them up. Right? If we do DevOps right, we're not going to do DevOps right by going in and saying, okay, I'm going to do DevOps, let's get started. It's not that way. It's a process. It's a bunch of learning that you have to do, and you roll out different aspects at different times as you're wading through some of the security implications, some of the deployment implications, some of the timing implications, stuff like that. but you're able to provide additional value to your organization very, very quickly. And it can actually give you a big heads up against your competition.
How are you handling the point of sale terminals? It used to be Windows XP embedded or some type of system like that. And as your systems progress forward, the hardware is no longer supported, yet this point of sale terminal has to continue to function. So how are you handling that?
Too deep of a question to get into. I could answer it if we had like 30 minutes to discuss. Mm-hmm. But let me give you a slightly different scenario, okay? And kind of show you how I walk through that. This is a company that I worked with just last week. They had 350 developers around the world. Most of them are in India. 250 of them are in India. 40 of them are in the U.S. and others, you know, different places. And what they're doing now is all of their developers are logging in to VDI on VMware inside of one of their data centers. They have data centers all over the country, several data centers actually around the world. And most of their workstations are running XP. But whatever the code that they're creating is J2E. Okay? So the Java is all going to be running on Linux, running on WebSphere. Doesn't really matter, right? They don't have to be on XP. It doesn't matter what they're on. We completely eliminated all of the challenges of that old workstation by simply giving them a VDI solution in the cloud. Okay. Will your point of sale work in that environment? Maybe not, right? That's part of what we have to dig in and find out what parts don't work. Let me skip through a couple more slides because this will make more sense in a different way. Skip this one. All right. So the purpose of DevOps is really to think about breaking down all the different things that your business does. And all the different applications that you run into smaller pieces. So a monolithic application is a large application that kind of the code is all compiled together, it all works together, it's all designed together. It's a legacy application, right? It's what we've always done. Who's written applications like that? Or who's worked with developers that have written applications? That's the way they've always been done. Well, there's a new way of doing things, and that is by refactoring. If you refactor the application so that you break them apart by feature, then you can roll out new features or change existing features without rolling everything out and upsetting the apple cart. Right? Now you're changing 10 lines of code instead of 80,000 lines of code because you've got 3 years of a development in this new monolithic, in this new upgrade to your monolithic application. Everything changes. Everything changes. It's a different mindset. So play this forward a little bit. DevOps versus monolithic, DevOps and monolithic versus microservices. So you can get by applying DevOps practices, you can help with a monolithic application. But your end goal is to really change your monolithic application to be more like a containerized application, where you have different features running in different containers and they're completely isolated. So when you update those features, you're having zero impact on the rest of the system. Then you have much less problems whenever it gets to the time where you're actually deploying those upgrades because there's much less that can hurt. Let's look at virtualization for a second. We all know that whenever we start virtualizing, virtualization is great, right? It saves us a lot of money. It allowed us to better utilize the hardware that we have in place. Instead of buying a 1U rack with 4 gig of memory and putting our website on and saying it should be enough for a while, right? And knowing that, anybody ever looked at the CPU cycles on those servers, those 1U servers running a website or two, right? They're like 1%, 2% utilization. A total waste of hardware. Virtualization solved that problem. Everybody agree with me? Plus it saved a lot of money in the process. If we take that one step further, what challenges did it give us? For some of you, it gave you no challenges because you still go to a keyboard and hit the KVM switch and you log in. For most of us, we don't have a KVM anymore because it's a virtual machine. You log into the host, and where is that virtual machine? Because I might have moved it because of utilization or whatever. Right? So it introduced management challenges. How do we solve those challenges? Well, we threw more software at it. Right? We created some management tools to allow you to manage those. It didn't matter where it was. We added additional capabilities as we went forward. We added storage, right? So you can have deduplication, and you can have you can auto expand volumes, including OS volumes, and all that cool stuff, right? We could deploy 10 gigabytes worth of data capacity, even though we only have a 2 gigabyte drive, right? That thin provisioning. We could do all that stuff. Gave us some great capabilities, but it brings challenges too. The challenges that it brought was management. But look at the monolithic versus the microsystem. It's awesome technology, but it has its challenges too. Some of its challenges are, well, first of all, what are some of the challenges of a monolithic application? Long development cycle. We talked to that a lot. Long deployment, upgrade, update, the whole stuff breaking and round and round and long QA and long everything, right? Very error and bug prone because you've got so much code that has to change and everything has to work together. Very expensive. Quick fixes are hard or impossible. Oh crap! The menu button for reports after I've done this whole rollout doesn't work. I gotta have reports. I gotta do a fix. How much testing is gonna go into that fix? Almost none. Because it's gotta get out right now, right? So those challenges just go away when we're talking about microservices. More bottlenecks, right? Because you have these intertwined pieces that are required to work together, and you can't just change one because it has an impact on the other. It's harder to test, and you end up with more changes at once. Whenever you split those services into smaller pieces, you have very easily to scale deployment code, etc. Faster execution, higher reliability. Let me give you an example of how this might look. You can read the slide. An example of how this might look. You guys know the old game Star Wars? You have your little ship, a little triangle ship, and you shoot rocks and they explode into smaller rocks, and loved it, right? One of my favorite games.
It was Asteroids.
Yeah, Asteroids, that's what it was. Asteroids. And think of that as a monolithic application. Everything's balled up in the executable and it just runs, right? That's a monolithic application. Think of that same application as a microservices application. In a microservices environment, you end up with the big rock is a microservice. It's one job, float around the screen, right? Until it gets hit by something. If it gets hit by another rock, it doesn't do anything. The rocks just pass through. If it gets hit by a bullet, it explodes. And it goes away. But before it goes away, it spawns a bunch of other microservices that are the other rocks. Some are small, some are medium, right? Other smaller rocks. It spawns those, and then it just goes away. So now you've got a whole bunch of microservices that are running. They're just more rocks. You follow me? The ship. It's a microservice. The microservice does nothing but accelerate and navigate around the screen. If it hits something, boom, I'm dead. Also has the capability of firing. When it fires, it's not tracking that bullet, it's just throwing a microservice into space and it's going in a straight line. If it hits something, it goes away. If it doesn't hit something, it eventually vanishes after it travels so far. Right? That's how a microservices application works. It puts all those different components, it can't get any simpler than that one application, right? Somebody actually did this. They wrote a microservices version of Asteroids, kind of cool. So they actually showed, Microsoft showed in a demo, where you could go in, change that one Microsoft that was your vehicle, change the color to green, one line of code change, redeploy, boom, it would eventually update. And all those different microservices, they're not impacted. Change the color of the rocks, guess what? Change the color of the medium rocks, what happens? Well, there's a couple different options there. You can have it automatically deploy, or you can have it deploy when a new rock is is spawned, right? So it doesn't do anything until a new rock is spawned, and when a new rock is spawned, so a new microservice is created, that's when it changes the rock to a different color. So whenever a medium rock was created, color was changed to red. When a small rock was created, the color was changed to green. So eventually, this was running, did this update live while they're playing the game, changed the colors, and you could see as you hit a rock and it exploded into smaller rocks, those new rocks would change to whatever color. That's what microservices is all about, is you make a small set of changes and you group those changes into a small feature, and then there's a little bit of overhead because you have to manage all of those working together, so there's some overhead to that. But it's a different way of thinking. And if you start thinking in that way, you realize you don't need to have all this 80-page document of what you have to go through before you do an update. You just don't need it anymore. You can, you're much more efficient in the way you're able to do things.
You haven't clarified what happens when your update's obsolete platform like the laptop you're running on. How does that happen?
If the update, say that again?
If the update obsoletes the laptop or the platform.
That is a problem.
How is that happen?
So if your application, first of all, generally that's not going to happen because the microservices are generally smaller than a monolithic application. But if they do, a lot of times they will require newer technology, right? And if your newer technology is not supported on your, whatever it is, XP or 18-year-old laptop, it needs to be replaced, right?
Or last week's laptop.
That's possible too, absolutely. You know, maybe your application is going to require Numinode isolation. It's not in my laptop. I happen to have a high-end laptop in order to use that technology.
So
I need to have virtualization enabled, whatever the case may be.
Don't want to buy it. How do I lock it? How do I stop the updates?
For Windows?
Yeah.
There are papers out there to tell you how to do that. There's challenges though, because if you stop updates, you stop all updates, right? And that means you're locked there forever. I mean, that wasn't the content that I'm delivering today, but yeah, you can, there's some registry tweaks. This is not an official Microsoft answer, but I know I've read out there, there's some registry tweaks that you can do to stop the update from happening.
So what's the official Microsoft answer? Update the hardware?
XP is no longer supported by
you. I don't care about the XP. It's, as Microsoft rolls forward, I have inherited tremendous amounts of equipment because it's no longer compatible with the existing Microsoft version. And I've simply repurposed it with other operating systems.
Sure.
So.
And Microsoft knows that's a lost opportunity for Microsoft.
Right. So their opinion is just replace the equipment, period.
Yep. As you need that new technology, it's up to you as to when that need becomes strong enough that the reward outweighs the cost. Mm-hmm. But we're not telling you how to upgrade your machines. We're just telling you, in order to get those new features, you need to be on the new OS or the new application, whatever it is that you're trying to run. Your machine has to support it, and that's always been the case, right? You don't upgrade from XP to Windows 7 if it's not supported, right? If you've got Windows XP would run with whatever it was, half a gig of memory. If you had half a gig of memory, you're not going to run Windows 7. Right? You got to upgrade the machine. Or don't upgrade to the newest technology. It's always been that way. Yeah.
Yeah, that was the technology. The problem I have is previous product, I work with a lot of vertical applications. Previous product ran on Java, certain version. Firefox, certain version. As those versions changed, the product broke. You had to lock it at that tested version until you could get a new version you wanted to test to.
So how did you fix that? Because there's a way to fix that. There's been a way to fix that for years.
Well, Java fights it. Firefox fights it.
But there's a way to fix that. What's the solution? Do you know? I'm going to tell you if you don't. So.
The next way we did that was to rewrite the product. But our customers hate to spend another, bucket load of money, basically a complete redeployment, to get away from Java, get away from Firefox.
That's certainly a solution. right? Another way to do it is you can always run that platform in a virtualization, virtualized, right? And stick to that. That's what I always did. Like whenever I was a developer for a decade or so. Whenever I worked on a project, I actually had a VHD for that project, right? So if I need to go back 6 months later and a customer wanted to add something, I'm not recreating that whole environment. I'm going to grab that VHD and start work, right? I don't have to worry about what DLLs are installed. I don't have to worry about did I miss something when I documented what's in there.
Yeah. Unfortunately, those two products were something we installed when customers became. Okay. So we had to prevent the customer from updating Java, prevent them from updating Firefox.
It's part of our job. It's our challenges. It's stuff we face every day.
If Windows 10 is going to go into that same model of continuous update, then that one update or another, I'm going to get that phone call from all of my customers who got that update that the product stopped working.
It's already happening. So, and the reality is the way to prevent that is to keep innovating, is to keep bringing your product forward, not sticking to the monolithic application that takes you 10 years to update. Start rewriting into a more agile type of an environment and investment, so that you can deliver updates to your customers faster, right? So that you can get them compatibility with the new hardware, compatibility with the new software, so that you can give them new capabilities. Read the book. Really, really powerful, and it'll help you understand some of these concepts.
Unfortunately, I don't write the base product. I build on it.
So, and really the people that fight this are the people that can't get their head around that splitting services, right? It's my application, it's the way I've always done things, why should I change? You don't have to change, right? Businesses that don't change, what do they end up doing?
Obsolete.
Yeah, they become obsolete. It's okay.
Well, that's the problem here is that I don't have the rights to all the keys.
It's a challenge. And part of the DevOps, lessons that you learn as you go through DevOps is how to present those arguments, how to skew the discussion in the direction that you want it to go. Right, that's part of what DevOps is learning how to make all of this magic happen when you don't own all the keys. Right, when you're not the owner of the company. Yeah, you got another question?
I was just thinking the doing aircraft software. I'd be curious to see how you fit that in.
That is interesting. Things like aircrafts, submarines, even cars. You know, the typical cycle for an update to a car, especially if it's a safety update, 18 months. Right? If you're doing something like, say, you want to add a crash detection feature, right, in your car. You want to put it in either if you have a heads-up display or you had a nav system or whatever, or you want to put a button in the thing. It's going to take 18 months to get it approved, right? Because it's got to be fully tested and all that stuff. There are cases when you have very long cycles that you're forced into. Why are you forced into those? The old way of thinking.
Well, that would be actually testing.
I'm dealing with testing.
But you can automate a lot of the testing too. But is it automated? Today it's not automated. When the whole world, when DevOps becomes as popular as virtualization is, a lot of these challenges will just go away. Not all of them. Especially when you're talking military. How long does an aircraft last?
40, 50 years now.
There you go. That's how long the cycle is. Yeah.
But the longer.
You can do updates. And they do updates.
Oh, they do massive.
Well, in the case
updates.
Of Navy, it's like they're still paying Microsoft for XP for like XP support.
I know. Yeah, I know. And they do updates, but yeah, they're not going to. They do those updates on a regular schedule. Usually, it's like 3 to 5 years. For military, it's even longer.
No, actually, it's fairly short. They are constantly upgrading this electronic countermeasures. The B-52 had to be significantly modified to support the new types of antennas it needed. They actually changed the airframe structure. Yeah, they do a ton of that.
Well, that's because they had the budget to do that.
No, in the case of the Navy, they're still, as of like last year, they're still paying Microsoft. I think it was like $100,000.
Oh, yeah.
They're like, it's like like a buku bucks to support
to
like
still support it. Yeah. Yep.
But the problem being is that the
but they don't actually control their budget though. Congress controls their budget. Kind of.
Yeah.
But you know what? And I mean, maybe this is getting into politics a little bit, but the reality is, Congress doesn't control their budget either. You know why? Because they usually get a rubber stamp for a large chunk of what they ask for.
Well, yeah, the reason.
Because it's not scrutinized.
This actually comes back.
Well, in the past it hasn't been. Who knows what's going to happen?
The competition in military aircraft and in military systems is tremendous once there's a war on, once there's asymmetric engagement going on.
Yeah, look at what happened in the last 10 years. Well, lots of changes.
Well, China, Iran, and Russia are significantly upgrading their systems. So there'll be a much higher upgrade rate on the different airframes.
That's all good for you, right?
It's just the problem is to prevent planes from falling out of the sky.
Yeah. I totally get it. I know. These are all challenges that we're going to be faced with over the course of the next 5 years.
My problem is
to prevent our customers from falling out of the sky.
Sometimes hardware refresh cycle in 15 years.
Not literally. Yeah, literally.
I thought I had another slide here. We're pretty much done with the presentation anyway. It's time to go. I do want to share one other thing with you, and that is time frame. How long is it going to take these cool technologies that I'm talking about to hit the mainstream? Docker, containers, party. 2 years, it's going to be as popular as virtualization. It is going to be that fast. Why? Because it's so easy. It saves people a lot of money. It saves a lot of resources. Easy, very, very low risk, very, very high gain. Lots of potential, lots of upside, very little downside. It's going to go fast. Changing monolithic applications to microservices applications, way longer. You're starting to see those applications come out now where they're using microservices technologies, but the reality, like this customer I was talking to last week, they have a monolithic application, and I asked them, how long do you think it's going to take you to rewrite your application? They got millions of lines of code, right? Many different modules, plug-in modules and stuff to add additional capabilities and stuff. We figure about 5 years. Is that okay? Call me at 10, let me help you out.
Yeah.
It takes time. The reality is it takes a lot of time. But read the Phoenix Project. Read the Phoenix Project. You'll understand all of this so much better. Okay, I don't have anything else. Thank you all very much for having me today. I appreciate it.
Thank you, Dan.
And we'll see you soon.